The problem with learning Python, or really any other type of coding, is that things tend to branch out and get complex very quickly. It's easy to feel overwhelmed, lost, or like you're trapped in an endless cycle of learning. I know this feeling because I've also been on this journey myself. Right now, I'm a software engineer at a big tech company, and before that, I've spent some time at AI startups and even game development companies. But if I had to start that journey from scratch all over again, I'd start it by learning how to code in Python. That's because I think Python is an excellent language to have as a core coding skill, and for how easy it is to learn, I think it's also extremely useful and extremely versatile. So if I had to learn Python coding again from zero, this is how I'd do it, knowing what I know today. I've broken this into 7 chapters, and for each chapter, you can expect to spend anywhere between 2 to 6 weeks, depending on how much time you have to dedicate to it. It's okay to take your time as well and take a little bit longer. However, I don't recommend lingering on any particular one topic for much longer than 6 weeks. Even if you don't understand it fully, I think it's okay to move on and then come back to revisit any of these topics later. Sometimes it's helpful if you're stuck to move on to something else and then come back with a different perspective. And that's because I think it's important to keep moving forward and keep the momentum going. Also, I've centered these chapters around solving real problems. My goal here isn't to understand all of Python in an exhaustive way, but just enough of the important parts to be able to build useful things with it. That's why if you notice certain topics or subjects being excluded, then it was probably done as a deliberate choice to keep our scope focused and narrow. If that sounds good to you, then let's get into it. Chapter 1, Get Started. The goal of this chapter is just to get going. That means setting up your environment, installing Python, learning the basics, and since we're new to this, also learning to get help when we need it. Now here's a list of all the concepts I want to learn. There's not too many of them, but they are going to be the building blocks of all the bigger things we're going to eventually build later on. So this includes things like data types, floats, integers, strings, variables, operations, like how to add or subtract things from each other, learning about conditions, like if-else statements, loops, collections of items, lists, dictionaries, functions, so that we can organize our code and then break them up into little pieces, and classes, also another way of organizing our code. By this point, we should just aim to do some very simple stuff like saying hello on the screen or calculating basic math problems like adding two numbers together. And since we're beginners at this stage, we're probably also going to get stuck very often and we'll also have a lot of questions. So let's use this opportunity to identify where we can get help from really quickly. And here are some of the things I recommend. So first of all, just go online and look for a cheat sheet. This is basically just an A4 piece of paper or something like that with a bunch of the most commonly used Python commands, and just print it out and have it on your desk or just have it saved as a file so that you can pull it up on your screen when you need it. When you start out, you actually tend to use a lot of very basic commands early on, but it's kind of hard to remember them. So it's a good idea to just have a cheat sheet that just puts everything all on one page right there where you need it. And if you run into something that you've never seen before, or you get stuck with a problem that you didn't expect, then it's useful to know who and where to ask. And for that, the classic way to do it is just to type your question into Google and then see what comes up. You might be redirected to Stack Overflow, which is a website where people post questions and comments. You can even ask your own questions there, but at this basic level, most questions will have already been asked on Stack Overflow, so it's just a matter of knowing how to search for them. Another tool that's new to the scene, but I think has a potential to be very useful, is ChatGPT. Go to OpenAI and ChatGPT, where you can try out the beta and type in any programming questions or any problems you have specific to your learning, and it might actually give you a very well-tailored answer. So give that a try as well. Finally, joining a community such as a subreddit or a Discord channel for Python could also be a really good way to get help, but also share your learning experience with other people who are on the same journey. By the way, I'm also planning to do a full course tutorial for things that you're seeing in this chapter, so an introductory course to Python. So if you're interested in that, then please subscribe to the channel so that you'll get a notification when it's ready. Chapter 2, Solving Simple Problems. In this chapter, my goal is to use Python to solve really simple, basic problems, just so that we can apply and practice all of the skills that we've learned from the previous chapter. For this, I recommend signing up to a website like LeetCode or HackRank, and then just going through some of the easy problems and writing solutions for them. Don't worry about doing medium or hard problems just yet. They will require us to learn about data structures and algorithms. That's also an important skill, but not what we need right now. Solving easy challenges is enough to help us get comfortable with the basics of Python, and it'll also help us build up the skill and the knowledge that we'll need to tackle more complex problems down the line. Chapter 3, User Interaction. The objective of this chapter is to make our Python scripts interactive and user-friendly. At the end of the day, we write our code for humans to use, whether directly or indirectly. So that means being able to read and write files, such as text files, images, and spreadsheets, and also being able to understand user input from things like the keyboard. One of the first things we'll cover is how to use the built-in modules that come with Python. These provide a range of functionality that we can use to build our applications, and we'll need it for everything else on this list. Next, we'll look at how to read and write files with Python. This is an essential skill to have if you want to build applications that can save and load data or work with external files. And that includes all types of files, whether it's a text document, an image, or an Excel spreadsheet that you want to automate. After that, we'll focus on capturing user input in Python, including using the built-in input function to capture user input and key presses directly from the terminal. Next, I would want to learn how to write a CLI, or a command line interface, with Python. I like using the inbuilt argparse library for this. This is a great way to build applications that can be run from the terminal from a single line. And this skill is actually super useful. On a weekly basis, I use Python CLI apps that others have built or that I've built myself to automate a bunch of tasks that save me hours at the end of the day. For example, I use a Python script to generate all the slides and images for this very video that you're watching from just a text file. Finally, we're gonna want to learn how to use the terminal and learn some basic bash and shell commands. This is not strictly a Python skill, but at this point in our journey, we're gonna need it for things like organizing our files, installing things, debugging, and a lot more. Now at the end of this chapter, and really every chapter going forward from here, I probably want to build a project to really solidify my skills, and I recommend you do the same. It's also something you can end up adding to your portfolio if you want to look for a job with Python, but more importantly, I think it's really the best way to learn. And here are some of my project ideas using the skills that we've built in this chapter. So for example, you can write a CLI note-taking app that you journal something once a day and it'll save that somewhere. Maybe a Python script to automate folder organization, like your downloads folder, or organizing things like images and zip files so that they're more categorized, or maybe deleting old files. You can use Python to automate spreadsheet creation. So if you have a spreadsheet that you're creating monthly, like for example, a workout spreadsheet or a budget sheet, you can use Python to automate that, collect data from it, and maybe create a new one for you every month. Chapter 4, build a web service. Our objective in this chapter is to make our Python code able to interact with the rest of the world. And we can do that by learning how to build a web service with Python and using some of the popular libraries out there for that. This is a valuable skill to have in today's digital world, and it opens up a whole range of possibilities for what you can do. First, we'll need to dive into the world of networking, HTTP, and REST APIs. We have to learn about the concepts behind these technologies and how to use them to build a web service. Next, we're going to want to learn how to use a package manager in Python and how package management works in general. And we'll be doing that using a tool called pip. So package management is a key aspect of working with Python because it allows you to install and manage external libraries that don't come default with Python. And that is what we'll need to be able to build more complex things. Next, I'd probably want to take a quick tour of all the popular Python modules that are commonly used for building web services. These include things like the request library for basic HTTP calls, Flask, which is the reliable industry standard for building a simple HTTP web server in Python, and FastAPI, which is a newcomer to the scene, but a rising star. My goal is just to get a rough idea of what each of these modules can do and how I can use them to build a web service in Python. By the way, I'm deliberately choosing not to spend time learning the Django framework here. I know that it's a big framework and it comes with sort of all batteries included to build an entire application, but I prefer to build things with a separate front-end framework and with a serverless architecture, and that kind of goes against what Django is about. It's a personal preference, but if I'm building a much larger app, I think it's a better developer experience to have my frameworks split up and my services split up into parts that use the best-in-class technology for each of those things. We'll take a closer look at some of those things in Chapter 7. And as usual, I recommend capping this chapter off by building an actual project with our newly acquired skills. Here are some ideas. We could build a personal blog website, we could build a REST API that tells you your horoscope, or if you're feeling a little bit more adventurous and want to learn more, we can look into building a web scraper to scrape stock market data and doing something with it. Chapter 5, Data Science. Next, I'm going to want to look into acquiring some data science skills. But what is data science anyways, and why do we need it? Simply put, data science focuses on collecting, analyzing, and interpreting large amounts of data in order to gain insights and to make informed decisions. It's a rapidly growing field, and it's being used across many different industries, from healthcare to finance to marketing. So why should we learn Python for data science? Well, Python is the lingua franca of data science and machine learning. It has a large number of libraries that are specifically designed for data science tasks, such as pandas, scikit, and matplotlib. But it's not just about the tools. Skills we pick up in this chapter will also be generalizable and definitely help us even if you don't end up doing data science or machine learning as a career. Any business large enough will have operational metrics and business metrics where your data science skills will come in handy, even if that business or that app has nothing to do with data science itself. So in this chapter, I would start by learning about data science, machine learning, and AI concepts. Things like neural networks, how to label data, how to train a model, and how to use it for something called inference, which is actually using the model to get your results. There's a lot of TED Talks or free MIT lectures or even online YouTube videos to help with this already. Next, we should get hands-on with some of the popular Python data science modules, such as pandas, scikit-learn, and matplotlib, and then use these tools to work with and visualize data. Finally, we can also take a quick look at some popular machine learning libraries like PyTorch and TensorFlow. These are powerful tools that are used for building and training machine learning models, and it's just a good tool to have some exposure to in case you ever want to venture deeper into the ML world. Even if you don't want to work directly in machine learning, I think it's extremely likely in the future going forwards that you're gonna have some interaction with a machine learning model, whether that's calling it through an API or interacting with it through another team. So I think it's really good to build solid foundation in this, even if you don't plan to use it directly yourself. And as a project to finish this chapter off, I recommend you taking part in a Kaggle competition. Kaggle is an online platform that hosts data science competitions. They give you all the data for free, and they even provide cash prizes for whoever can use that data to most effectively solve a given problem. It's an incredibly fun way to learn, and there's a great community around it too. But the best part about it is that you actually get to work on real interesting problems using real data. For example, these include things like forecasting house prices, detecting cancer cells from X-ray images, or predicting the winner of a football tournament. These challenges are already fun enough and interesting enough on their own, but if you manage to master them and actually solve these problems, you can actually take your learnings from doing that and use it to solve other types of problems that you might have. I actually did participate in a Kaggle competition about a year into learning Python myself, and even though I didn't win the competition, the portfolio and the work I produced from it actually did get me quite a few job offers after it was done. But more importantly, from doing that, I learned a lot of useful skills that I still apply today. Chapter 6, Developer Productivity. At this point in our journey, we're probably at least a couple of months into learning, and we've developed quite a decent set of skills. But our momentum is starting to slow down as projects get larger and more complex. To fix that, we're going to have to level up our developer productivity. The focus of this chapter is to learn about the tools that can help us scale, work faster, manage complexity, and collaborate easily with other people. First, I would focus on learning Git and GitHub if I haven't already. Git is a version control system. This is something that's widely used by developers to track changes to their code over time. So it's kind of like a way to save your project and have different checkpoints. And it lets you roll back to any previous checkpoint in your project in case you do something catastrophic, like deleting a folder, or maybe you lose your hard drive. It's also essential for any developer that wants to work on a team because it lets people work on different parts of the code and kind of combine them without them overwriting each other. If there's going to be some kind of override, or if two people are working on the same file at the same time, it makes it clear that there's a merge conflict and you have to explicitly decide how to solve that. So you wouldn't accidentally overwrite someone's piece of work, and neither would someone accidentally overwrite your piece of work, which is really important for working together on a big project. GitHub is a popular website that hosts Git repositories. So GitHub and Git are not the same things, and it's probably a good idea to learn the difference between them. Git is an open source command line tool that, you know, is very widespread and used everywhere. GitHub just happens to be one of the popular online platforms for hosting Git projects. It's a great place to store your code or share it with other developers. It's the most popular. That is why I'm recommending to learn it. Next, I'd look into doing unit testing with PyTest. So unit testing is the practice of testing small, isolated pieces of code to ensure that they work as expected. You can use it to catch and fix bugs quickly, and you'll be able to release your code with more confidence. A good set of unit tests will also prevent regression in your program, where you might be having a really large project and then you work on something that sort of breaks something else completely unrelated really far away, and then you don't find out till later. So if you have unit tests that are set up properly to test the entire project, when you actually break something, then your unit test should fail. So this is a good way to expand your features without being afraid that you're accidentally going to break something. In other words, this will improve your development speed and your ability to scale as your projects get larger. PyTest is the most popular testing framework for Python, and it makes it really easy to write and to run unit tests. So that's what I'd recommend learning. I actually have a video tutorial about it as well if you want to learn it quickly. Next, I'd recommend spending a little bit of time getting familiar with your IDE of choice. IDE stands for Integrated Developer Environment. You can just think of it as your code editor. The two most popular options for Python are either VS Code or PyCharm. Personally, I used to be a big PyCharm user myself, but recently I've switched over to VS Code. I just think it works better across full stack development that have other code mixed in, like JavaScript or TypeScript. But whatever IDE you choose, it's good to spend a little bit of time learning about all the add-ons, extensions that are available to help you sort of simplify all the stuff that you do on a regular basis, learning all the hotkeys so you don't have to click through things manually, that saves a bit of time, and learning how to use debugging tools like breakpoints to be more productive. Finally, I'd spend a bit of time exploring any other developer tool that I might have heard about or maybe just searching for them explicitly that can help me work more efficiently. These might include tools for task management like a Trello board or tools for code formatting like the Python Black library, which automatically formats your Python code file so that you never have to think about it yourself. Chapter 7. Full stack and cloud development. Now, this is going to be the most challenging chapter yet, where we really have to venture outside of our comfort zone to get that final missing piece of the puzzle. Full stack cloud development skills will allow you to build an entire product end to end by yourself. This means giving it a nice mobile friendly web interface, deploying it to the cloud so that people around the world can access your application 24/7, and other basic fundamental things for an app to work as a business, like user authentication, data storage, payments, and integration with outside services. I would start by brushing up on my HTML, CSS, and JavaScript skills first, since that is the language of the web. Then I'd look into one of the more popular front-end frameworks like Next.js or Svelte. After that, we'll need to learn how to use a cloud platform. A cloud platform is basically a pay-as-you-go service for things like web servers, database, data storage, and basically anything like that. It's generally much easier and much cheaper than having to physically set all of that stuff up for ourselves. There's a couple of options for choosing a cloud platform, but I'd probably go with AWS since it is the most widely used one. And if you want to get a job, then AWS is also a highly in-demand skill to have right now, since so many companies are using it. And as usual, I recommend to finish off this learning milestone with a project. At this point, we should have enough skills to attempt a larger project with maybe even things like user authentication and payments. Here are some ideas for inspiration. You could build a to-do list that people can log in and it saves their to-do items. You could build a fitness app that generates workout routines and people can subscribe to it. Or you can build an AI-powered app that generates custom images or writing content for our user. So this has been a rough blueprint of how I'd learn Python coding from scratch if I had to start over. But the reality is, the learning journey never truly ends. By gearing this plan towards acquiring a wide range of skills as quickly as possible, I'm really hoping to put you in a strong position to continue learning and maybe even specialize in a new area of your choice, whether that's robotics, game development, data science, blockchain, or anything you want. Please let me know what you think about it, and if you have any questions, or if you think there's any skills or libraries that you think I should have included. By the way, if you are new to learning Python, and you find yourself struggling with bugs, syntax errors, or generally figuring out how to do things, then be sure to check out my other video here to see how you can use AI to help you with your coding. Otherwise, see you next time, and thanks for watching.